Hello everyone. This week we are looking at a book titled The Almanac of Naval Ravikant. Naval Ravikant, as most of you would be aware, is an icon in Silicon Valley and the startup world. He's an angel investor and he bet early on in companies like Uber, Twitter, etc. In Twitter and via his blogs, he shares his own philosophy on life, wealth creation and happiness. And I have been an ardent follower of his tweets. And this book tries to collect and organize his thoughts and pieces of wisdom in a more consumable format. And because I was following his tweets, I thought I should read this book and understand what goes on in his head when he is tweeting such thoughts. This book has been collected by another person who also follows Naval Ravikant. Now, moving on to the summary of the book. Naval was a child in a household of poor immigrants when they moved to the US. He was brought up by a single parent and his mom. And through difficulty and struggles, he has come up to live a life that we see him doing today. It is a story of inspiration for all of us, hence all these thoughts that he gives out becomes very, very crucial and important for us to understand because of the background that he has come from. The book is broken into three main portions. Naval says that all our life's efforts are driven towards these three key principles. It's wealth, health and happiness. While we tend to go after wealth and then health and then happiness, in fact, it should be the other way around, is his philosophy. You should follow happiness, health, and then wealth. The first section of the book is about building wealth. And he talks about how do you build wealth without being lucky. Of course, you could become a millionaire overnight by winning a lottery, but he talks about what are the things that you should do in order for you to be wealthy without being lucky. He talks about a wide variety of things. I am just trying to give a simple gist of three or four key points. The first point is about you cannot become wealthy by doing simple hard work and labor. You can't be slogging for 8 hours a day and 365 days in a year and expect to become wealthy. That's not going to happen. You got to own an equity in a business which can generate wealth for you even when you are asleep and are not working, right? That's the first simple point. The second point is build specific knowledge in a domain wherein it becomes very difficult for somebody to replicate or do what you are doing. But for you, it's a child's play. It comes as a second nature to you, right? So build that kind of a knowledge which you can use against the society and then generate rewards for it. A third point is leverage. What he means by leverage is that in order for you to amass wealth in larger proportions, you've got to have some leverage against the rest of the world. Right? It could be in the form of access to capital or access to cheap labor. And in recent times, he says code or a piece of software is a leverage which has become very, very accessible for anybody and everybody to use. So if you have the capability to build a product or a piece of software and then sell it also, it can work for you every day and night without you having to do anything on top of it. So leverage in the form of a code is another important thing that you could do in order for you to build wealth. And the last portion is on compounding. We all know the effects of compounding in finance, but he also talks about effect of compounding in work. What kind of work do you do? Do you play short-term games in workplace, or do you stay with the company for long-term investments? And also in terms of maintaining relationships, compounding plays a critical role. So these are some things which can help you build wealth without being lucky. The other important point is if you have to take such kind of decisions and calls, your judgment and decision making has to be absolutely immaculate. So he talks about that as a separate portion. And Naval says that wisdom is nothing but knowing the long-term impact of things that you do. And judgment is knowing and applying this wisdom to external problems that you face in life. And in order for you to make better judgments, you've got to be a very clear thinker and try to understand any problem statement from fundamentals using first principles based thinking. That way, you'll be able to understand any problem statement and make a clear judgment out of it. But the problem that we face generally is that our egos have been shaped and formed right from childhood by a lot of inputs and learning. And hence, we take judgments basis that molded ego which is there with you. Rather, he says, at times of making crucial judgments and calls, ignore all of that and take a step back and basis pure facts and rational inputs that you get at that point in time, take the judgment, is his recommendation. Of course, in order for you to do all of these things that we just spoke about in making the right judgment, you need certain mental models because you can't assimilate and understand every problem statement and every situation from the past and try to make judgments in the future. So you crystallize all of them into mental models. How do you learn mental models? You've got to read, read and read. And he says that don't worry about the topics that you are reading. Keep reading as long as you are able to not put the book down. And whatever interests you, keep reading it, right? So building wealth and then making right judgment and decision making go hand in hand. This is about the building wealth portion. The next part is about happiness. And he uses a very important word here. He says, learning happiness. It's not that you are born a happy person or happiness happens to you. You've got to learn it. He says it's a skill like playing a piano or playing cricket. It's a skill that you have to build by working on it. He talks about how in our lives we have attached this happiness to everything which is external. Meaning, you become happy when you buy a house or buy a car or a lot of money, etc. And hence, these things are out of your control. And hence, when they don't happen, you become unhappy. Rather, you should focus inward and see if you can tie your happiness back to something which is very internal. Maybe your internal peace or internal well-being. And hence, that is something that you can control. And hence, happiness becomes a very natural thing that can happen to you. Of course, this goes into the area of Buddhist philosophy of letting go of desires, etc., and all of that. But he acknowledges that point also throughout the book of the Buddhist shade that he brings about in his philosophical topics. And the other point is about building good habits to build happiness. He says that because habits is what makes you as a person, and hence if you build good habits throughout your lifespan, it becomes easy for you to learn to be happy rather than forcefully trying to identify situations or things that can make you happy. This can become your second nature. Happiness can become your second nature if you inculcate good habits is the point. The last portion is around health. You could think about becoming healthy or a fit person and then go to a gym or go to a trainer or a dietitian, etc. At the end of the day, you have to realize that the responsibility of you being fit rests with you only and nobody else other than you. The moment you take that thought process clearly into your head, everything else falls in place. Of course, he talks about having a proper diet, less sugar diet, etc., and also having a regular workout every day so that you are physically healthy. The key point that he emphasizes is on mental health also. He says that if you're mentally healthy, you tend towards becoming physically healthy as well. And by mental health, he talks about doing meditation as his method of being mentally healthy. Meditation doesn't mean that you'll have to do a lot of thinking, etc., and all of that. He says it's a very simple thing that he does every day. 1 hour, he sits into a he goes into a room, calm room, does nothing else but sit there idle and think about his own thoughts only, nothing else, right? And he says meditation is about switching off society and switching on and listening to your own inner thoughts, right? So he says that initially you will hear a lot of cramming that goes on in your head. The brain is like a monkey. It has a lot of thoughts going on in your head. The moment you create this habit of spending that 1 hour with your thoughts, the amount of nonsense that goes on in your head starts to come down and you become mentally more healthy, is the point. He also talks about not setting specific goals for both mental and physical health, but creating an atmosphere and environment around you where you can thrive to behave the way that he's talking about, and hence become a better version of yourself, right? Of course, he talks about a term called as rational Buddhism. He takes all the rational and the good thoughts from Buddhism, starting from this desire portion, thinking internally, the meditation part, etc. Of course, he does not get into this karma, the afterlife, etc. He ignores all of that. So he calls this as rational Buddhism, and I liked that thought process personally. Right. With that, we come to the end of the summary. It's a very small and short book actually, but with powerful thoughts actually. I am very sure I'm going to reread this book multiple times for me to assimilate these thoughts within me. Moving on to the key takeaways from the book. He says, don't choose a job because the job is in vogue. Build specific knowledge and choose a job which can't be trained by somebody else and can't be repeated. This will give you the leverage that you need against the society for you to amass wealth. Second point is, be a first principles based thinker and a clear thinker. This can help you understand any problem statement or any situation and find a solution to the problem with clear judgment. And in order for you to do this, you'll have to keep reading and reading and keep building and accumulating mental models. The third point is, it is important we stay healthy mentally and physically before we start become wealthy. And this can come via the interpretation of happiness, and that happiness is a skill that you can build by dedicating time and effort consciously to learn the skill. With that, we come to the end of this week's book review and summary. I'll catch up with you with another interesting book the next week. Till then, goodbye.